Okay, so two phrases that are really thrown around a lot in talk about antibiotics. Or two things are antibiotics and antimicrobials. So antimicrobials are usually drugs that encompass everything. So they kill bacteria, they kill fungi, viruses, still for debate. And then antibiotics fall under the umbrella of antimicrobials. Antibiotics are a type of antimicrobial that kills bacteria. There are two categories. There's therapeutic and non-therapeutic. So therapeutic antibiotics are antibiotics that are used with the intent of healing. They're there to kill, like if you have an infection, they're there to kill the bacteria that are there. They are used in both human and animal medical practices, and they're given at high doses over a short period of time. So they're there to basically just wipe it out and start over. And yeah. So then there's non-therapeutic antibiotics. They're the same drugs. They're just given in different doses and given with different intents. Usually they're given at a low dose over a long period of time, and they're given only to animals, typically for growth promotion. So the animals that are receiving them are not receiving them because they're sick, they're receiving them because the owners want them to get fat. Of the 29.9 million pounds of antimicrobials used in the US annually, which are basically almost completely antibiotics, 87% or 26 million pounds are given to animals. And then of that 26 million pounds, 93% are used non-therapeutically. So really it's only a teeny tiny fraction that are being used to treat infections. The rest are all being used as growth promotion and other things like that, but usually it's growth promotion. So the mechanisms, they interrupt specific processes within the life cycle of a bacteria. They're non-specific, meaning that antibiotics just kill all bacteria. They don't kill a specific bacteria. There are narrow and broad antibiotics. So the narrow antibiotics target a certain like shape or class of bacteria. It's still gonna kill anything that's similar to whatever the target is. But they are better than broad antibiotics, which just kill everything. And then there's two types of antibiotics, like two groups. There are bactericidal drugs and bacteriostatic drugs. So bactericidal drugs, they attack the cells primarily by focusing on the cell wall. They either prohibit the formation of the bacterial cell wall or it breaks it down. They also target the DNA synthesis and RNA synthesis and protein synthesis, but all of the antibiotics in this group are there to kill the bacteria. Versus bactericidal or bacteriostatic, which only inhibit the growth of cells. So they target processes that are essential for the cell to replicate. So that cell is going to live its life, whatever, but it's not going to be able to duplicate and continue to infect. So when it dies, and that's it. But it'll die when it's its own time, whether the body kills itself, or it just dies because it's the end of its own life. So the processes it needs to multiply are DNA replication and RNA replication. They need to be able to metabolize different chemicals and things so they can live. And so it inhibits enzyme activity and other metabolic activity. And also protein production, because proteins are essential for everything. So this is just a table that's also on my paper. It breaks down some of the bigger classes of antibiotics by how their mechanisms are, or like what mechanisms they use to stop the infection. So some common ones y'all might be aware of are like penicillin, which is a cell wall synthesis, fluoroquinolones. I'm going to talk about those eventually. Those are very common for urogenital infections, so basically anything southern region. And then vancomycin, which is cut off a little bit over in the cell wall synthesis, that I'm going to talk about as well. And that is like the main last resort antibiotic. That is an antibiotic that is used when nothing else works, and that's kind of like you're on your deathbed. If you don't take it, you're gonna die. So gut microbes, your entire gastrointestinal tract is completely covered with bacteria, good, bad, primarily good. They play a crucial role in digestion. You wouldn't be able to break down food without it. That's why people who are lactose intolerant, they lack the necessary bacteria to break down lactose. And that's what gives you all of those unfortunate symptoms. It's also extremely crucial for the formation and development of the immune system. Additionally, it's part of the gut-brain axis, which is basically your brain and your gut kind of work together. The nervous system all encompasses all of it. And there's a lot of studies that I didn't read too many for this thesis, but there are a lot of studies that have shown a significant connection between like what you eat and how your gut is composed, and certain mental issues, but other just imbalances. It's also really important to say what you would die without microbes in your system. And there are approximately 800 to 1,000 different species. So that's just groups like humans or species. And then 7,000 or more different strains of bacteria in the human intestines. So that's just your intestines. And then, fun fact, your body has 10 times more bacterial cells than human cells. So you're mainly bacteria. They're just small animal cells. So this is a really great quote. Vaccines and antibiotics have made many infectious diseases a thing of the past. We've come to expect that public health and modern science can conquer all microbes, but nature is a formidable adversary. And that's by Tom Frieden, who is the former director of the CDC, or the Center for Disease Control and Prevention. He actually just resigned this year. So it's non-specific. It kills all bacteria, good and bad. And antibiotics severely disrupt your gut. They just like I was saying, your entire gut is coated with microbes that are essential for living. And so mitochondria and chloroplasmic processes. So for those of you who don't know, the mitochondria is the powerhouse of the animal cell. So that's where you get a lot of your energy. It's essential for everything, really. it's very important. And it has its own DNA separate from your like main DNA. And the same goes for chloroplast, and chloroplast is found in plant cells. So it's basically the plant equivalent of the mitochondria. They were the first organelles in eukaryotic or like animal and plant cells to evolve from bacterial cells or prokaryotic cells. So that was the first thing that kind of started to distinguish the prokaryotic cells from the eukaryotic cells. So their DNA structure is very similar to bacteria, which is not good for us. So here are the three different DNAs. And as you can see, they're all very similar in structure. And because of that, when you take an antibiotic, particularly one that targets DNA replication, you're disturbing these the DNA in your mitochondria cells as well. And it's an issue for plants because antibiotics can pass through animals and stay relatively intact. And then things like manure get spread on plants, and then now that your plants don't grow as well, it can cause lots of issues. So antibiotic resistance.
What if I told you there were trillions of tiny bacteria all around you? It's true. Microorganisms called bacteria were some of the first life forms to appear on Earth. Though they consist of only a single cell, their total biomass is greater than that of all plants and animals combined. And they live virtually everywhere, on the ground, in the water, on your kitchen table, on your skin, even inside you. Don't reach for the panic button just yet. Although you have 10 times more bacterial cells inside you than your body has human cells, many of these bacteria are harmless or even beneficial, helping digestion and immunity. But there are a few bad apples that can cause harmful infections, from minor inconveniences to deadly epidemics. Fortunately, there are amazing medicines designed to fight bacterial infections. Synthesized from chemicals or occurring naturally in things like mold, these antibiotics kill or neutralize bacteria by interrupting cell wall synthesis or interfering with vital processes like protein synthesis, all while leaving human cells unharmed. The deployment of antibiotics over the course of the 20th century has rendered many previously dangerous diseases easily treatable. But today, more and more of our antibiotics are becoming less effective. Did something go wrong to make them stop working? The problem is not with the antibiotics, but the bacteria they were made to fight. And the reason lies in Darwin's theory of natural selection. Just like any other organisms, individual bacteria can undergo random mutations. Many of these mutations are harmful or useless, but every now and then, one comes along that gives its organism an edge in survival. And for a bacterium, a mutation making it resistant to a certain antibiotic gives quite the edge. As the non-resistant bacteria are killed off, which happens especially quickly in antibiotic-rich environments like hospitals, there is more room and resources for the resistant ones to thrive, passing along only the mutated genes that help them do so. Reproduction isn't the only way to do this. Some can release their DNA upon death to be picked up by other bacteria, while others use a method called conjugation, connecting through pili to share their genes. Over time, the resistant genes proliferate, creating entire strains of resistant superbacteria. So how much time do we have before these superbugs take over? Well, in some bacteria, it's already happened. For instance, some strands of Staphylococcus aureus, which causes everything from skin infections to pneumonia and sepsis, have developed into MRSA, becoming resistant to beta-lactam antibiotics like penicillin, methicillin, and oxicillin. Thanks to a gene that replaces the protein beta-lactams normally target and bind to, MRSA can keep making its cell walls unimpeded. Other superbacteria, like Salmonella, even sometimes produce enzymes like beta-lactamase that break down antibiotic attackers before they can do any damage. And E. coli, a diverse group of bacteria that contains strains that cause diarrhea and kidney failure, can prevent the function of antibiotics like quinolones by actively booting any invaders that manage to enter the cell. But there is good news. Scientists are working to stay one step ahead of the bacteria, and although development of new antibiotics has slowed in recent years, the World Health Organization has made it a priority to develop novel treatments. Other scientists are investigating alternate solutions, such as phage therapy or using vaccines to prevent infections. Most importantly, curbing the excessive and unnecessary use of antibiotics, such as for minor infections that can resolve on their own, as well as changing medical practice to prevent hospital infections, can have a major impact by keeping more non-resistant bacteria alive as competition for resistant strains. In the war against superbacteria, de-escalation may sometimes work better than an evolutionary arms race.
Okay. So antibiotic resistance is a really big issue that isn't getting enough attention right now. Some of the mechanisms, similar to what they just said in the video, are that that they don't kill everything. Oh, so what happens is when you take an antibiotic, even though it's not specific and it theoretically kills everything, it does leave some behind. And those that that stay behind, as they were saying, were naturally selected. They had some sort of resistance that allowed them to survive that specific drug. The thing that we have to remember is that antibiotics are not meant to do all of the work themselves. I kind of struggled with this. I forgot going into it that, I figured that antibiotics are supposed to do anything. That's what's supposed to cure you. But it's really more of an aid. It's there to assist your immune system. It's going in and making the level of bacteria go down so there's less numbers, and it allows your immune system to go in and take over and keep the rest of the bad bacteria at bay. Unfortunately, there are these bad, unsightly consequences that come with it. So what happens when you take an antibiotic, it wipes everything out except for the ones that are resistant, and then they are very opportunistic. Where the good bacteria used to live and were colonized, now it's empty. It's anyone's game. And the ones that get there first and get to colonize first are the ones that get to set up shop and stay there. So some of the primary opportunistic bacteria include members of the genera bacterioids, Streptococcus, Enterococcus, and Staphylococcus. So those are like some of the big ones, and those are the ones that are very common to find resistance in. So resistance can be passed on to the bacteria's offspring. So this gene that made them resist the bacteria the antibiotic that was given, it's mutated, it's permanently mutated, and so when it separates or replicates, bacteria kind of like split. But when it replicates, that gene is passed on to its offspring. So now you have more and more and more resistant bacteria. They also can just kind of spew it to neighbors as well and make them resistant. So this is, I believe this one was from the CDC. It's just a flyer with some interesting information on it. So on the right, it says that only 10% of adults are prescribed the correct antibiotic for strep infections. 10%, that's it. Only a 0% correct prescribing rate for acute bronchitis. So that means that every single prescription that's given for bronchitis is wrong. So doctors are just giving antibiotics, and they may help, they may not, but overall it's usually not the correct one for that specific bacteria. There's over a 4% increase in antibiotic prescription rates over the last 14 years. So the rate of prescription is going up. People want a prescription, they go in to the doctors because they feel sick and they want a prescription. I want to feel better, they think an antibiotic's going to do it. Antibiotics aren't always going to do that. For instance, a cold and the flu, neither of those can be cured with antibiotics. They're both viruses, and antibiotics don't touch viruses. There's some other stuff too. Okay, so the human effect. It can lead to severe illness and death. There are people who go in for just minor surgery and they're exposed to some form of a resistant bacteria, like MRSA, or the resistant staph infection is very common in hospitals. And so there are people that go in for surgery, like to fix their knee or something, and end up dying because they get an infection that they can't fight and that no antibiotic can fight, and it's sad. And hopefully we can stop it by changing some of our practices. There's a growing rate of antibiotic resistance cases. That's just in general. Some of the big ones are MRSA. That's the one I've heard the most in like the news and stuff, which is methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus. There's a higher risk for people with weak immune systems, such as children and the elderly, as well as those with diseases including cancer, diabetes, liver and kidney disease, alcoholism, and HIV and AIDS. So what happens is we all probably have bacteria that are in us that are resistant to something, but our body and our immune system is able to keep it at bay enough that it doesn't really show itself. We can have them, but it's not gonna have any symptoms unless there's an excess in numbers. So those who have weak immune systems aren't able to keep those bacteria that they come in contact with at bay, and then you have an infection that's resistant, and then now you have antibiotics that don't work, and you're much more likely to have the severe cases in people with weak immune systems. So vancomycin, which I talked about before with that big table, it's banned in animals in the U.S. I think it's for everything. So for therapeutic and non-therapeutic practices, it's banned in the U.S. I believe you can still use it for therapeutic practices in Europe, but it is very common in the U.S. in hospitals because it's the last resort. But it is overprescribed, and so now we're seeing a lot more cases of vancomycin-resistant enterococci. So there's about 20,000 hospital patients that contract it each year. And then of those, 1,300 patients die with the infection. So animal effects. This is kind of more of my primary focus within the thesis. So animals, they get diarrhea from antibiotics. And then this leads to dehydration and potential death, especially if they don't take care, like if they're not on top of it. Of the 20 million pigs in Canada and 100 million pigs in the U.S. that are slaughtered each year. About 1 in 10 dies before being weaned. So they don't get to the point where they can actually be a profit. They just basically live a really sad beginning to their life because they're on antibiotics and they're not able to, they get dehydrated, they're not able to process food correctly, and they end up dying. But more than half of them are due to gastrointestinal infections. So that translates to $200 to $300 million lost in revenue each year. So, the World Health Organization estimates that farmers only profit about 1% by using antibiotics. So most farmers use them for growth promotion and think that it's going to give them a bigger profit because they're getting bigger animals with less food. But they're losing a lot as well. So they end up not really profiting much. So then there's also the issue of foodborne illnesses. You know how we're supposed to cook food to the right temperature and wash your vegetables because of manure and all this stuff. It wouldn't be that big of an issue if we didn't use antibiotics. What happens is we give antibiotics to animals, whether it's whether we overuse them intentionally or unintentionally, and their gut gets wiped out, and then you have opportunistic bacteria like E. coli and Salmonella that are able to then go and inhabit and colonize the gut. And so now they have excess amounts of E. coli and Salmonella. And so when the animal is processed, things get a little messy, I know from experience. and so that's when you get contamination. And you have to worry about all of these other things, making sure your food is to the right temperature to make sure that you kill the bacteria. And it wouldn't really be that bad. E. coli and Salmonella are not supposed to be in large excess in an animal's gut. They're supposed to be, it's there, but not to the extent that we see it now. And then if they're resistant bacteria, then when you eat it, if you get an illness, like if you get food poisoning from it, then now you have consumed bacteria that are resistant, and so now you have a resistant infection. So antibiotics can pass straight through the animal system while remaining chemically intact, which is kind of scary. It's not like it goes in and your body takes care of it. It goes in, does its thing, and then you poop it right out. And so when manure will run into the water systems, it spread on crops, it gets spread throughout the entire ecosystem. And then there's more, it's just a whole big thing. So excretion and metabolism. So depending on the substance, the mode of application and the excreting species and time after administration depends on how much is metabolized, how much is excreted, how chemically intact it is. On average, the excretion rates for tetracyclines and sulfonamides vary between 40 and 90%. So that means that 40 to 90% pass through the gut. And it passes through the animal and are excreted out, and they're fine. Some other substances remain relatively inert in the body, like amoxicillin is only between 10 and 20%. So if intracorporeal degradation takes place, it takes place in the feces. So if it does, if it does degrade in the body, it's going to do so in the feces. If it's not metabolism, they persist in the environment. So again, they get shipped out in the environment, Earth at the time. And then they remain in the environment in an unaltered state. So this is like a big diagram showing all of the different ways that antibiotics can travel throughout the ecosystem. Yeah, just look at it. So as you can see, everything's all really intertwined, and it doesn't just stop with you. It gets passed along. Here's another one. This is an example of how antibiotic resistance can spread. So there's two different ways. One, the antibiotics are given to George, and the other, the antibiotics are given to an animal. So we'll start with George. So George gets the antibiotic, and then he develops resistance. And then he goes out into the community and spreads it. He touches things, he coughs, he just spreads it through contact. And then he also was in the hospital or nursing home or other care facility, and so now it's spread there. They also go to the, it just keeps going and it spreads. Every time you come in contact with someone or something, you spread your bacteria, and if they're resistant, you're spreading resistant bacteria. So for the animal, they develop resistance, then you have fertilizer or water that contains some animal feces as well as the resistant bacteria, and that goes to crops and other things that humans consume, and also there's the meat section, again, cross-contamination and stuff, and you can consume resistant bacteria through that as well. Oh, here's another one. I'm just going to skim through this one. I think you guys are certainly important. So you can get it through food. You can get it through exposure, you can get it through eating the food. And about 1 in 5 resistant infections are caused by germs from food and animals. Oh, so this one. These are 2 pictures that I took when I did I had to design a lab myself, an experiment myself. My first semester here, in my first semester bio class, is eating disorder, anatomy, and care. And I did mine on resistant bacteria. And so these were leftovers, or like, they're not leftovers, but the pictures were leftovers from that. And so the one on the left shows the bacteria culture that was from meat found at our farm. And so, as you can see, there's like this whole open area where the bacteria didn't want to come close to that patch, which was soaked in, well, this one, it was hydrochloric acid. But I did a couple different antibiotics as well as hydrochloric acid. And then this one was the resistant one from Shaw's. So, as you can see here, there is bacteria growing right on the patch, so it didn't care. You can give it as much hydrochloric acid as you want, and it's still going to grow. And this is actually what inspired me to do this thesis. So it's all full circle. Okay, so children, asthma, and the immune system. So as I said earlier, your gut and the microbiome in your gut is essential for developing your immune system. So if children who are given antibiotics under the age of 1, they are much, much more likely to develop asthma and other immune disorders later on in life, because their immune system hasn't developed yet. They're still in the process of developing, and so by giving them antibiotics, now you wiped it out and it's disrupted that development. So they're much more likely to develop issues like asthma and other immune system disorders. The use of antibiotics in animals. Okay, so effects on farmers and animals. So there are a couple studies that were done looking at the handlers and the animals' gut. So in the first study, they looked at poultry feed that was supplemented with tetracycline for 5 months. So they gave them to the chickens for 5 months. And after the 5 months, 31.3% of the farmers contained, their fecal waste, contained tetracycline-resistant bacteria. And only 6.8% of the neighbors' samples had resistant bacteria, meaning that you can't associate it with the environment. It was because they were directly handling the food. So they weren't even consuming it. It was just the fact that they were there and handling it. They had it on their skin, they inhaled dust. And so they had resistant bacteria. And in second study, this one, the feed was supplemented with oxytetracycline, which is a variation of tetracycline. The chickens' intestinal microflora quickly became dominated by drug-resistant bacteria. Within 6 months of using this feed, the farmer's gut microbiome was 80% tetracycline-resistant coliform bacteria. So 80% of the gut was made of this one resistant type of bacteria. And then the chickens were also heavily resistant as well. And both the chickens and the farmers' plasmids, which is part of the bacterial DNA, could be resistant to more and to other antibiotics. They had the characteristics, meaning they were altered enough that they could easily become resistant to a bunch of other antibiotics. And then they also looked at what happens after you stop using the antibiotics and you stop being exposed to the antibiotics. So then 6 months after stopping using the antibiotics, almost the entire, almost all of the farmers' fecal matter was completely free of resistant or tetracycline-resistant bacteria. So it was able to get out of the body, whether it degraded itself or just went away on its own, or the body got rid of it, it's gone, because you weren't continually introducing the gut flora to the bacteria, to the antibiotic. So pigs, right? Yes, pigs. So air samples were collected from swine concentrated animal feeding operations. And they tested, they wanted to see if they could isolate any bacteria from the air. This is just the air. And they tested enterococci, staphylococci, and streptococci, which are all opportunistic bacteria. And they tested them for the antibiotics, erythromycin, clindamycin, and virginiamycin. Oh, and tetracycline and vancomycin. So, luckily there were no traces of vancomycin, which is good because they're not allowed in animals in the U.S. But 98% of the isolates showed resistance to at least two or more of the other antibiotics. So basically, everything was resistant, which is scary, especially considering that was just from the air. So if you walk in, you breathe that in, now it's in you. therapeutic use. So, a lot of farmers go in with the good intentions of trying to keep their herd healthy. So they go in, one animal gets sick, and so try and prevent it. They will just give antibiotics to the entire herd, rather than just the one animal that's showing signs, or the few animals that are showing symptoms. This is really easy because over the counter, you can buy veterinary antibiotics over the counter. Granted, they're the same antibiotics we use, but they're with the intention of being for animals. And so they're creating resistance of their own by trying to be good and trying to keep their animals healthy, and in turn actually hurting them and themselves. So weaning. So the North American industry, like swine industry, uses the practice of early weaning and medicated early weaning. So what they do is they take the piglets when they're very young. Usually, traditionally, piglets are weaned within 21 to 35 days. And with this practice, it's just within the first 5 to 18 days. It kind of varied. So what they do is they take the piglets, they try and wean them really quick, so they can get them away from the mother and put them into a sterile environment, thinking it's going to keep their gut from, it's going to keep them from contracting any illness and try and keep them healthy. The thing is, though, is that they're taking them, they're putting them in a sterile environment, they're giving them antibiotics, so there is nothing there. They're not able to process anything, they're not able to digest food properly. The first time they come in contact with any antibiotic, they're basically doomed because they have nothing set up. And additionally, being with their mother's milk transfers antibodies, which help the immune system develop, and it's just, nature did it that way for a reason. It needs to stay that way. And so this leads to really high rates of dead piglets primarily because of diarrhea, because they're not able to either process the food correctly, or it's also because any bacteria that they come in contact with, it's gonna be detrimental. And so this demonstrates the incredible need for increased awareness in the livestock industry. Some do this with the hopes of trying to make them fatter and for growth promotion, but a lot of the time they're trying to do it to help the pigs. They're trying to do it to keep them healthy, and in turn they're making them not. So Europe's pretty good. They used to do the early weaning, and then they ended up switching to regular weaning. So they let them stay with their mother until it's like the proper time. Additionally, in 1992, European officials banned these antibiotics as growth promoters. So they have not been allowing antibiotics to be used as growth promotion for a while now. And they found that this did not affect the economy of the pork industry. So they were using these antibiotics to try and make the pigs fatter so that they could make more profit, and then it ends up being that there isn't a difference. So why do we keep doing this? So this ended up leading to healthier practices, such as incorporating the weaning to the full term. And then by 2008, the amount of antibiotics used per pig dropped by more than 50%. So the average amongst all the pigs dropped 50%, basically. And overall, the productivity increased from 18.4 million to 27.1 million pigs being weaned. So they're able to get a lot more through and healthier because they aren't using antibiotics. Okay, so probiotics. It is an effective alternative to antibiotics as far as growth promotion goes. So, and it's also an estimated $20 billion industry. And so even the pharmaceutical companies will benefit, because that's also a concern, is the pharmaceutical companies wouldn't be that much. They're making a lot of money off the antibiotics right now. So having an alternative such as probiotics to turn to would help them as well and reduce resistance from them. So antibiotics have to be considered an antibiotic, there has to be in vivo data, and there has to be proven health benefits for named strains. So it has to be named, has to have benefits, and there has to be data supporting all of this in the animal or human. The issue is it's difficult to determine which strands are going to be the most beneficial, because there's so many that are in here. Some of them have been found to be beneficial, though. One of them is L. Rhamnosus GG, which has been shown to stimulate the immune response and has a stabilizing effect on the gut permeability and suppresses allergic reactions in food hypersensitivity. So if you have a food hypersensitivity, maybe you want to give this a try. And lactobacilli, it has been shown to have microphage proliferation, held in cytokines, especially tumor necrosis factor alpha, and IL-6, IL-10, IL-12, and then it also helps with nitric oxide production. So a combination has been shown to prevent adhesion and growth of enteropathogens, so those bad bacteria that enter your system. So if you have a weak immune or a weak gut colonization, by taking these, it's been shown to prevent those opportunistic bacteria from growing and colonizing within the gut, and that allows your other bacteria to come back and recolonize. So again, it prevents adhesion and the growth of enteropathogens. And lactobacillus was discovered to stimulate significant growth in animals. Part of this is because, well, now you have a healthy gut, so you're able to digest, or the animals are able to digest and use the nutrients properly, rather than skipping out on a bunch that they couldn't digest before. It's been shown to be very beneficial when given during stressful periods, so giving to lactating mothers, in animals, during times of transportation, any major stressful event in their life, something that's stressful on their body. And there's been studies that also show that there are correlations between what type of gut system that animal has and the microbial clusters that are found within it. So a monogastric versus polygastric animal. So monogastric, those are things like humans that have just the whole gut. So pigs would fall into that category. That's the main one is pigs. So there's that whole big major group. gonna read it up for this whole time. But Phylloformis and Bacillus subtilis reduces weight loss in lactating sows. It has been shown to reduce the incidences of diarrhea and mortality in piglets, and it has improved overall litter weight at weaning and the overall growth rate of young pigs. So it ends up being very beneficial. The mothers are better, the babies are better, just better all the way around. And you're not risking antibiotic resistance. Also, Bacillus has been shown to lower the prevalence of diarrhea. Again, there's less food needed to attain the same weight gain, so farmers don't have to spend as much on feed because they're actually using the nutrients the way they're supposed to. And it's also been shown to improve the quality of the meat as well. So pork meat, the color is better, there's more marbling, and it's more tender, the flavor is better, and it's juicier. There's also something that I've been put in here, but for chickens that you've given, chickens who are given antibiotics, their shells are thicker, the eggs themselves have lower cholesterol, and better flavor as well. Oh, I meant probiotics. If I said antibiotics, probiotics. So, polygastric are things like cows and other ruminants, and sheep and goats, and sheep and goats. So the most common marketed product is live yeast, and that's been shown to increase dry matter intake and milk production in dairy cows, and it's also improved growth parameters, so like average daily gain, final weight intake, and feed to gain ratio in beef cattle. And it also stabilizes ruminal pH and decreases the risk of acidosis, which is a common digestive disorder in high producing cows, whether it's beef or dairy cows. This allows for greater fiber digestibility, which is due to there's a better ruminal bacterial densities. So there's more bacteria and greater densities in the rumen, which is part of the stomach. It stimulates growth, and it also increases fiber degradation in cellulitic microorganisms. So regulation, so these are kind of the parameters of what, or the criteria for, let's see, probiotic, and to be considered a probiotic, I like both in the US and Europe, even if they're not like all specifically the same, it's the generally the same. I'm not gonna read through all of them. So farmer benefits. There's limited exposure and likelihood of feeding resistance, so now you're not using antibiotics. So you're not getting antibiotic resistance, your animals aren't getting antibiotic resistance. It's great all the way around. You have a better quality product. Just like before, marbling's better, flavor, juiciness, all that. And you also have healthier animals, you have better nutrient absorption, you need to use less food, you have more that survive, and so overall you have a lot more profit. And our benefits as the general public are there's less foodborne illnesses because now you don't have this excess amount of E. coli and salmonella and other bad bacteria due to the antibiotic use. And you have better tasting and more humanely raised food because now they actually get to enjoy their lives and not have diarrhea all the time. And we don't die from resistant bacterial infections. That's a wonderful thing. the policy. This one. Yes, we know what he did. It's the history. So there are no set international standards, which even though that antibiotic use affects everyone equally. So it's not that great. Europe is using different standards than the US, and developing countries are using different standards than Europe and the US, and it's not great, especially considering people travel between all of these countries, meat travels between all these countries, and just animals in general travel. And so you're spreading all of this without equally regulating it amongst the different areas. So there are four areas of intervention focus that when you're doing a policy intervention. So first one is education intervention, so by increasing education, like tonight. Another one is managerial strategies, so by talking to different groups and having overall managerial. Regulatory interventions, so by changing regulations, you can make it change. And then economic interventions, so by talking about money, like you make more profit using probiotics rather than antibiotics, and you lose a lot of money using antibiotics. The World Health Organization has played a huge role in antibiotic regulation. It's a UN-based organization that kind of is like our international standards, but they don't actually create the policies. They just give suggestions. And then in 1974, there was a study based out of Tufts University that determined that low doses could cause antibiotic resistance. That was in 1974. We're a lot farther from 1974. So Europe. So in 1960, Europe banned specific medically important antibiotics from use as growth promoters. This did not include chemical analogs, though. So you can have an antibiotic, and there's a lot that fall under a similar umbrella. So you have like penicillin, amoxicillin, those are like the first two that come to my head. But there's a whole group of them there. And they're different, but they're very, very similar structurally. Similarly, so avoparcin was used in livestock as a growth hormone, and it is very, very structurally similar to vancomycin, which is the last resort drug. And so there was resistance, even though they weren't using vancomycin, there was still resistance developing for it, or to it, because they were using avoparcin. In the 1970s, it actually was approved as a growth promotant. And then eventually they ended up banning all antibiotics for growth promotion. And also in 1995, Denmark drastically restricted how much vets could profit off of antibiotics. So they were making almost a third of their profit off of just the antibiotic sales. So by restricting it, you're restricting how much they can give for growth promotion and for other like non-essential antibiotics, and they'll be much more choosy about what they give. And in 2009, they began imposing fines for the overuse of antibiotics. And then they also heavily monitor them by finding out who is prescribing the drug, what is it being prescribed for, to what animal, how much, how long, all of that. They did this before they did the ban on all growth promotion and have continued after to see the difference. The U.S. does not do that. So the U.S., some of the important drug government agencies that control or do most of the policy making for antibiotics are the Food and Drug Administration, or the FDA, which that's a major one. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, or the CDC, and the United States Department of Agriculture, or the USDA. So vancomycin was never allowed as an additive in feeds. So that's good. In 1977, the FDA proposed banning penicillin and tetracycline as additives. Unfortunately, nothing happened. It took until 1999 for environmental groups to petition that they continue going. That didn't work, so they tried again in 2005. Still didn't work. So in 2011, a lawsuit was filed by a OBEG. It's a coalition of different organizations and groups that wanted this petition to be put in place, or this proposal to be put in place. And the agency denied the citizen petition. And so they rebutted and challenged the agency and brought in the federal judge, who ordered, it took about a year, and then the federal judge eventually saw that there was plenty of data supporting them, and ordered the FDA to move forward with the ban. And then in 2013, the FDA finalized its voluntary guidelines on antibiotics. So it took over 40 years for something to happen. Okay, so the FDA, something good. They are doing some things right. Antibiotics that are for human use are only behind the counter. They have to be, they cannot be over the counter. They have to be prescribed. Medically important drugs, or what they classify as medically important drugs, which are drugs that are used for humans, cannot be used for growth promotion in animals. They're currently collaborating with stakeholders for a new labeling to restrict the use of antibiotics on the labeling, which is then, if you violate it, you violate the Food, Drug, and Cosmetics Act. And then they're also working with the USDA and CDC to increase the data collection, so they're trying to do what Europe is doing and collect more data on how the antibiotics are being used and stuff. And they're collecting it and putting it in the National Antimicrobial Resistance Monitoring System. And they're also transitioning to all antibiotics for animals being behind the counter, so they need to talk to a licensed professional before they can get the antibiotics. So the bad. It took 40 years for the debt, and they needed the federal judge to force them to make a change. So that I might be a pessimist, but that does not give me much hope. Data collection is still weak. They're getting there, but it's still weak. And without data collection, policy isn't gonna happen because they'll say there's not enough science to prove it. Then there's by having antibiotics be bought over the counter, you can go online, you can Google it, I Googled it. You can go online and buy any antibiotic you want, really. There is a limited interaction with licensed professionals, so they aren't getting that exposure and that education to know that giving the entire herd an antibiotic is actually not good. And that there are these other bad things associated with it. Also, who is enforcing labeling? I guess they do get inspected, and farms have certain things that they need to adhere to, and there are people that come around and check. But overall, I mean, yeah, you break the label, you end up, you violate the act, but no one's there watching all the time. You can do whatever you want. You have a bottle of antibiotics. And you can say that it's for therapeutic. You say, oh, they're sick. So we're just gonna keep giving antibiotics. And on top of that, they're working with stakeholders for the new labeling. So that's not in place yet. They're working with stakeholders such as big farmers, but also pharmaceutical companies and veterinarians and other people who are making profits off of using antibiotics. So I guess that could be a good thing, because it could help move the process along, because they feel like they're being part of it. But at the same time, is it gonna affect the quality of the restrictions, and is it gonna actually hinder it, because they don't want to stop? They're making a lot of money off of it. So it's also slow. So, what next? So we need to continue researching the benefits of probiotics, the best probiotics for specific animal guts, alternatives to antibiotics, and better antibiotics that reduce the occurrence of resistance. The more information we have, the better equipped we are to tackle it, and the better policies we can make, and the less people can hopefully die from it, and less animals can hopefully die from it. The better policy regulating and enforcing antibiotic use, both in veterinary and human medicine, because human medicine isn't all that great either. They have their weak spots. So what can you do, all of you? So limit your own antibiotic use. Seek alternatives. They make alternatives for, like, you can and try and prevent stuff, boost your immune system, that type of stuff. Know that the common cold and flu are viruses, and you're not supposed to get an antibiotic for that. You can question your doctors. Byproducts raised without non-therapeutic antibiotics. So by you being a consumer and buying things and putting this other pressure on the farmers, if more people want antibiotic-free meat, they're gonna start making, or like, they're gonna start doing it antibiotic-free.